I got shot. I always felt like I'd be shot. Somebody tried to do me some harm because a lot of people don't like me. But I didn't think it was going to happen at that particular moment. I'm surprised, but I'm happy. I believe that, this is all in God's hands. And I'm very appreciative to God for everything I've gotten to do. But also about death, we look at death from a selfish side. Like, that guy died. Oh, it's so sad. Why is it sad? He's away from all of this bad stuff that's here on earth. At the worst, he's just somewhere quiet, no nothing. At best, he's an angel. Or he's a spirit somewhere, What is so bad about that? Throughout my life, I just wanted to be like an angel for God. Do something where I could be of some help. And I can do that. I'm an artist. So it's not like I have to tell the truth. All I have to do is tell a story and reach you, and get some kind of feeling from you. And then try to get the moral across. So this is my story. A story about ambition, violence, redemption, and love. When I was young, I was quiet, withdrawn. I read a lot. I wrote poetry. I kept a diary. I watched TV all the time. I stayed in front of a television. And I could see all these people out there in this pretend world. And I knew I could be part of it if I pretended to. The way Arnold used to look when he used to come out on Different Strokes. I used to like the lifestyle, the way he used to live. So early on, I just watched and emulated. And I thought maybe if I can be an actor and I could act like those characters, I could have some of their joy.
Oh, thank you, Mr. D.
If I could act like I had a big family, I wouldn't feel as lonely. Shaq's responsible for all my success.
I'm the original two-tone, big-nose, skinny rapper.
Shaq G. This lady named Layla introduced me to Adrian Gregory, who was managing Digital Underground. He was like, I'm gonna send you to Digital Underground. They're in the studio. You just rap for Shaq G on the spot. If he like you, then I'll pick you up. Yeah, I just walked in, rap for him. He's like, okay, good, you're in. Boom, 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 I'll see you later. And I just left, walked out of there like, dag. Shaq was like, come on the road. You could be my roadie, you know what I'm saying? It ain't gonna be glamorous, but you'll be working, you'll be meeting people. I said, cool. Got off the road, he said, well, I'm gonna pay you this, and I'm gonna let you do same song. I did same song. Ever since then, it's been on.
Tupac, go ahead and rock
now
this.
Now I clown around when I hang around with the underground. Girls used to frown, say I'm down when I come around. Gas me, and when they pass me, they used to diss me. Harass me, but now they ask me if they can kiss me. Get some fame, people change, wanna live their life high. Same song, can't go wrong if I play the nice guy.
Claiming fame must have changed now that we became strong.
I remain still the same, cause it's the same song.
I look back with the greatest fondness. Those were like some of the best times of my life.
Watch this, bro. I'm gonna fuck you up. I'm gonna fuck you up. TJ Mark the 45 King, this is your thing. Check out how we swing. Look at my ding-a-ling and know that I am the king. A lyrical lunatic. I can rap so quick about pissing on politics. Don't matter if the girls be on your dick.
Adrian had been shopping my demo tape as a solo artist. Then all of a sudden, Interscope got in touch with us, and I was told that Ted Field, this millionaire, multi-millionaire, his daughter had heard my demo, and she liked it. So he was like, that's how I picked you. And I was like, whoa, tell your daughter thanks.
You know you gotta love the sound. It's from the rebel of the underground.
So I went from being unknown to now having a platinum record. I love women. I'm not gonna lie. I love women with a passion. I do. I feel like sometimes now I just be wanting to call Prince and just be like, can we hang? Because I love women like he love women.
Hey, man. Oh, Lord. I've been talking to little girls all day. Since somebody my age. How you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
I have respect for women, ultra respect for women.
I like being around females. I'm comfortable. I can get with them on every level. I don't get like a predator thing going when I'm around demure females.
Don't be shy.
Y'all making me blush. You got me blushing.
I'm not uncomfortable around strong women.
Oh, sorry. I'm not enough for you.
No, you enough. I'm looking you up and down, but on TV, they're gonna be like, look how he looking at
Tommy. No, don't do that.
No need to ask. He's a smooth operator.
Madonna is real nice. She's a good person. She helped me a lot. She was real cool, like any one of my homeboys. Jasmine Guy, she helped me. She's a good supporter. Jada Pinkett. Jada's my heart, you know what I mean? She will be my friend for my whole life.
Well, maybe I'll be down to scoop you up later in life. You ain't all shriveled up.
We'll be all together.
Be like Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee.
Vic, you know you always got a place in my heart.
She can have my one heart, my liver, my lungs, my kidneys, my blood, marrow, all of that.
Keep your head. Keep me up, ooh, child. Things are gonna get easy. Keep me up,
I think my mother taught me to understand women a lot more than my peers can. When I was young, I was surrounded by strong women. My sister is the bomb. She's my biggest critic. She's real smart. Funny as all hell, she's real funny. My mother was a matriarch. If you're raised by a woman, you're gonna have feminine characteristics. You're gonna think like a woman.
Since we all came from a woman.
When I'm saying thug, I mean not criminal, someone to beat you over the head. I mean the underdog. The person that had nothing succeeds, he's a thug. Because he overcame all obstacles. It doesn't have anything to do with the dictionary's version of thug. To me, thug is my pride. Not being someone that goes against the law, not being someone that takes, but being someone that has nothing. And that even though I have nothing and there's no home for me to go to, my head is up high. My chest is out, I walk tall, I talk loud, I'm being strong.
I am against racial and ethnic entitlements. I think they are un-American.
I don't understand why America doesn't understand thug life. America is thug life. What makes me saying I don't give a fuck different than Patrick Henry saying, give me liberty or give me death? What makes my freedom less worth fighting for than Bosnians or whoever they want to fight for this year? They should give money to the ghetto. I mean, I think even gangs can be positive. It just has to be organized and has to steer away from being self-destructive to being self-productive. I organized the OGs in the East Coast and the West Coast and the penitentiaries to come up with codes of ethics for criminals. It's called the Code of Thug Life. It's a code putting order to the violence on the street. In Watts, Compton, Chicago, wherever, we got all these people all over the country saying, yes, we go by this code, we're gonna be against attacks on people that are not involved with the street gang, with the drug trade, or the illegal business at all, you know, all that kidnapping and shooting drive-bys out the car, we're against that.
It's thug like that. It ain't just a bunch of niggas going crazy. We wanna control our streets. So all we saying is if every motherfucker that was out here right now gave up $1, and they put it to this Thug Life Fund, the money don't go to me, it go to somebody from y'all neighborhood. They take the money, and we do this shit like every month. I be bringing new rappers in here, I be bringing Snoop, whoever the fuck y'all want. I go smash the niggas. And for that shit to happen, we can't have no violence, and everybody gotta be.
Yes, my raps are filled with rage.
One of these days, we gotta bust back for the homies.
You have to be logical. You know, if I know that in this hotel room, they have food every day, and I'm knocking on the door every day to eat, and they open the door, let me see the party, let me see like them throwing salami all over the, I mean, just like throwing food around, but they're telling me there's no food in here. You know what I'm saying? Every day, I'm standing outside trying to sing my way in. You know what I'm saying? We are hungry, please let us in. We are hungry, please let us in. After about a week, that song is gonna change to we hungry, we need some food. After 2-3 weeks, it's like, you know, give me all the food, we're breaking out the door. And after a year, then you just like, you know what I'm saying? I'm picking the lock, coming through the door, blasting, you know what I'm saying? It's like you hungry, you reached your level, you don't want any more. We asked 10 years ago. We was asking with the Panthers. We was asking with them, you know, with civil rights movement. We was asking, you know. Now those people that were asking, they're all dead and in jail. So now what do you think we're gonna do? Ask?
I put my gun away and grab my AK. It's getting hectic, I can't call it. House full of alcoholics, now a nigga's under pressure.
There's a bad part because the kids see that and they mimic it. That's the part I haven't figured out yet. But the positive side is the kids who live in a household where the mother is a crackhead or whatever, and he hears the rap, he's like, oh, that's everyday thing for them. So I don't have to feel ashamed. It cuts both ways. To me, it's like when I say I live the thug life, baby, I'm hopeless. One person might hear that and just like the way it sounds, you know what I'm saying? But I'm doing it for the kid that really lives a thug life and feels like it's hopeless. So when I say hopeless, and when I say it like that, it's like I reach him. You understand? And even if when I reach him, it makes it look glorious to the guy that doesn't live that life. I mean, I can't help it. It's a fad, you know. He'll drop the thug life soon enough. But for the person that I was trying to reach, he'll pick it up and I'll be able to talk to him again.
Do you think there's a double standard in terms of men being promiscuous?
Yeah, but I mean, you're the one start that double standard. You know? We didn't start that double
standard. I'm not saying you started anything,
and I'm not saying
but
that
I mean,
it's fair. I'm just saying
right.
This is how it is. How can we rap about a world that is not like that? This is how it is.
But do you look down on your male friends if they're as promiscuous as some of the women in your songs?
I don't look down on anybody that's promiscuous. Only people I look down on are people who don't control the situation. If a girl sleeps with a lot of guys, she's still my homegirl. I don't care. You're only a bitch if, not because you sleep with a lot of guys, but because you're only sleeping with them for money. So now you put a price on yourself.
Right, or because they have a nice car.
Yeah, guys, when they sleep around, they do it for free. At that particular time, a lot of girls, they seen my face on TV so many times that that's what they want. They want to be associated with that person. It's the fame that get these people. It is not me. It is the fame. Because I watched females look at me when they didn't know who I was, and I can see it, nothing. And then as soon as somebody whispered who I was, it's this glare in their eye. You make yourself want that person, you know?
How do you feel about that?
I don't understand how people could stand next to you 1 year, and next year, they cannot stand there. They just going crazy screaming. They just can't take it that you're right there. But just last year, I was in the same club, walking around lonely like a motherfucker, you know what I'm saying? Couldn't get a date, couldn't get nobody to dance with me. I was too skinny, too something, and now he's just adorable. He's just all.
Any artist out there want to be an artist and want to stay a star and don't want to have to worry about the executive producer trying to be all in the videos, all on the record, dancing, come to Death Row.
When I got out of jail, the West Coast, East Coast shit was really started.
Wait. The East Coast don't love Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg. The East Coast ain't got no love for Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg and Death Row.
West Coast was Death Row. The East Coast was Bad Boy.
Check this out. I'm the executive producer that a comment was made about a little bit earlier.
Everybody thought it's a war for record sales and attention and all of that. But to me, it was personal. I love the East Coast. I'm from the East Coast. But then I felt like Puffy and Biggie and all of them, they want to dirty up everything I worked for. So it made me come back more relentless. I'm mad at Biggie, I'm rushing the nigga. What's the problem?
Yo, Piggy, man, we got it going on, baby. It's on and cracking, man. He's gone, baby. You the man, you the man.
So I directed videos.
Huh? You alive? I mean, you safe? Man, I'm so happy you're free.
Yeah? Happy to see you. A lying piece of shit.
Pop, please don't kill me. It was Buff's idea.
No, man.
I'm just a rapper, man. Please don't take me out the gang.
I ain't gonna kill you. We was homeboys once, Pig. Once we homeboys, we always homeboys. Even if you is a fat phony. And I did a song with Faith, Biggie's wife.
Faith, my homegirl. I just wanna send a shout out to Faith. Hey, girl.
Then I did hit him up.
That's why I fucked your bitch, you fat motherfucker.
Which is a classic battle record.
First off, fuck your bitch in the click you claim. Westside, when we ride, come equipped with game. You claim to be a player, but I fucked your wife. We bust on Bad Boys, niggas fuck for life. I'm a self-made millionaire. Thug living out of prison, pistols in the air. Biggie, remember when I used to let you sleep on the couch and beg a bitch to let you sleep in the house?
Just after the Mike Tyson-Bruce Seldon fight, Shakur, along with record company executive Marion Suge Knight, headed for a nightclub. But while stopping at this intersection, a car with four people pulled up and opened fire on Shakur and Knight.
Tupac Shakur was shot several times in the chest. The driver, his record producer, was grazed in the head.
He's returned to the intensive care unit tonight after another surgery, still listed in critical condition.
All week long, fans of Tupac have gathered here outside the hospital.
He's undergone two operations since coming here. He's had his right lung removed. He is intermittently conscious. Jesse Jackson's been here. Family continues to keep vigil. And despite early reports that his wounds were not life-threatening, people at the hospital here continue to tell us that he is in very serious condition.
At 4:03 this afternoon, Tupac Shakur was pronounced dead.
Who shot me?
Shit, I don't know. Sorry. My death. It's a tragedy like Shakespeare, I guess. But I have no bad feelings. I have love for everybody.
Please welcome the mothers of Biggie Smalls and Tupac Shakur, Afeni Shakur and Valletta Riley.
Coming to grips with my past, it was hard. I don't feel like what I did was so evil. I just feel like the way I was living and my mentality was a part of my progression to be a man. But you grow, we all grow. We're made to grow. You either evolve or you disappear. I don't want to be forgotten. I'll always be a troublemaker to some people. But I still get love from my community.
I got love for my brothers, but we can never go nowhere unless we share with each other. We gotta start making changes. Learn to see me as a brother instead of two distant strangers.
I owe them everything. That's what I owe everything, to the hood. I got love there. I got love from thugs and the street dudes. And that kind of focuses me back on what I should be doing. Lay out the real map on the world and how it is. The message is, young black males could do anything if you just give us a shot. Stop trying to beat us down. And to my homeboys, we need to be in control of ourselves. I'm not saying I'm gonna change the world, but I guarantee that I will spark the brain that will change the world. So keep your head up. Do what you gotta do. And then, inside of you, I'll be reborn. I always wanted to do a movie on my own life. So, here I go. You can watch me when I'm happy. I got love. I got love. When I cry, I have a great deal of remorse. When I get shot, when I go to jail, this is not the spot. When I die, it's just, it's a tragedy like Shakespeare, I guess. It's sad, but I got so many good memories.
She's a super freak! Super freak!
It's a coming of age story about temptation, weakness, fortune, and fame. That's the bomb right there.
It's been 7 years since his tragic death, but Tupac Shakur's influence can still be heard in the work of some of today's hottest rap stars.
Tupac's influence is on the entire hip-hop community. You had to see it, he's one of the best, period.
Tupac was definitely ahead of his time, so that's one of the reasons that his music can still live today.
The new movie, Tupac Resurrection, is more than just another ploy to make money off the memory of the late rap icon. The film was executive produced by Tupac's mother, Afeni Shakur, and it's told entirely in Tupac's own words.
I got shot. I always felt like I'd be shot, but I didn't think it was going to happen at that particular moment.
Tupac's remarkable story still resonates among his many fans, both in and out of the music business.
Yeah, I definitely want to see the movie.
I'm interested in seeing it.
I can't wait till it come out.
Some of Tupac's friends have already seen parts of the film, and their reviews are in.
When it first came on, it caught me off guard to hear him say what he said, and just to see how it all came about. It's tight, clever.
I'm happy that people will get an opportunity to see Tupac.
and that it is told in his own words.
As a rapper, an actor, and an impassioned black activist, Tupac left behind a legacy that continues to inspire the hip-hop community to this day.
He became like what Martin Luther King or Malcolm X was to our generation. You know what I mean? That's when Pac talked, you listen. He had such an effect in the short time he was here on the generation and the culture of hip-hop.
Tupac found his voice as a rapper and was much admired for his brutally honest lyrics.
Tupac was a mean lyricist. You know, rhymes that can be heartfelt as soon as you hear them.
I think that honestly, Tupac was the greatest songwriter to ever live. He made it seem so easy, but you still could connect with him and the emotion was there and you saw a picture that he was trying to paint. And if there is a little bit of me, that's, you know, that's what I picked up from him.
When you hear Pac's voice, it's something about his voice that just grab you.
Out on bail, fresh out of jail, California dreaming. Soon as I step on the scene, I'm hearing Hoochie screaming, fiending for money and alcohol, the life of a West Side player with cowards die in a strong ball.
He always had a different style, and he always came from the heart. He would always feel the words he was saying.
Tupac was the first rapper to make art out of the most intimate details of his own life, thus opening a new creative door for the rappers of today.
He used a large portion of his life in his music. I do exactly the same thing. My records.
Many men wish death upon me. Blood in my eye, dog, and I can't see. I'm trying to be what I'm destined to be.
He's someone that, you know, I've seen come before me that was able to speak exactly about his situations.
But Tupac rose above the testosterone-drenched rap scene with Dear Mama, a touching tribute to his mother.
When I was young, me and my mama had beef, 17 years old, kicked out on the street.
He did things that a lot of rappers were afraid to do. He would go inside.
Dear Mama, that song alone in my life, you know, lasted about a year with me in the car, just playing it every day. If you had tough times with your mother, it made you like almost want to go, oh, Mom, you know, it made you want to like overlook everything you were going through.
It got me a couple of times. You know, I had to call my mom. Mama, I love you, Mama.
And even as a crack fiend, Mama, you always was a black queen, Mama. I finally understand for a woman it ain't easy trying to raise a man.
Both of us had mothers that were addicts. That was one of the things when we were younger that we really connected to and related to with one another. He told me he was writing a song, Dear Mama, and I was like, damn. How does your mom feel about that? You know what I mean? And his thing is like, yo, it is what it is. He could reveal the undeniable connection that you have to your mother no matter what is going on. And I just always admired him for that.
In fact, Tupac wasn't afraid to reveal anything about who he was and what he felt, an artistic strategy that still works today for one of his staunchest admirers, Eminem.
If there is any way that me and him connect, it was just being able to take what's going on in our lives and be able to put it in words and write about it.
I said, I'm sorry, Mama. I never meant to hurt you. I never meant to make you cry. But tonight, I'm cleaning up my closet.
It's almost like you're feeling it, so you write it. People feel like they can relate to you.
It's try to envision witnessing your mama popping prescription pills in the kitchen.
Later, you may think about it, like, maybe I shouldn't have let people know that, but, you know. And I want people to understand what I'm going through, and this is the best way for me to put it.
Tupac actually put it a bunch of different ways. He was a man of many, sometimes contradictory moods.
He was a ball of fire and a ball of energy that if you rub the wrong way could turn at you and bite you.
Bad boy murdered on wax and kill. Mess with me and get your caps peeled. You know.
One of the things that Tupac allowed other rappers to do to this day was contradict themselves. People go through different types of emotions and different types of things and points in their lives where they feel certain ways, you know? You can't just feel one way all the time. Something's wrong with you if you're happy all the time.
To me, like, Pac appeared like he was, like, out of control. The way he carried himself, the way he moved around, and that's what made him such an exciting entertainer.
So now I gotta throw away, floating in my black bin, trying to do a show a day. They wonder how I live with five shots. Brothers, it's hard to kill on my block.
It was somebody who really lived it, who was actually going through it, and who could really tell you about it. He was so likable because his style was fun, but at the same time, he was dealing with some real situations.
He was 10 Tupacs in one. He was so complicated. There was nothing simple about him. Nothing.
Coming up, some exclusive scenes from the extraordinary new movie, Tupac Resurrection.
You're in jail now. Won't be any more rapping for a long time for you, huh? I'll be like, well, actually, my album is number one in the country right now. I just beat Bruce Springsteen.
And more reflections on the man and his art by those who knew and loved him.
It was just like me, you know what I'm saying? I felt like we were like brothers, like the same kind of people.
Tupac Shakur was one of rap's greatest artists and one of its first major stars, but he was also a fine actor, and in the new movie Tupac Resurrection, he tells in his own words his approach to creating a film character.
When I get a part, first I just try to find out, you know, how does this character feel, and like I make the person up in my mind. What does he look like? Try to put a face to him. Even though it's my face, I give him a walk and give him an attitude. All you really have to do is relate to your character.
Tupac's first starring screen role was in the 1992 movie Juice. It was a fairly routine ghetto crime drama, but Bishop, the menacing, gun-crazed character Tupac created for it, still resonates in today's hip-hop world.
You gonna do is shoot me in the elevator?
I was blown away with Bishop.
Bishop, that guy is in my neighborhood. The mentality that was expressed through that film, it lives right there on 134th Street, where I'm from.
When I first seen Juice, I mean, my reaction was probably like everybody's reaction was like, yo, this dude is crazy. It's kind of like you looked at him like, all right, he's acting, but is he really acting? Is he, like, crazy for real?
I read for the same part Tupac read for in Juice. But he won out. He go up in there with his line. I just hear flying all over the place. He left, and I'm looking at him like, this cat got it over here. When it comes to this movie thing, he got it.
Until Denzel did Training Day, I thought Pac's Bishop was one of the best bad guys I've ever seen. He just had it.
Check yourself, Q. You got to snap some collars and let them motherfuckers know you there to take them out anytime you feel like it.
Naturally, there were some people who saw Tupac playing a scary, gun-wielding gangster who assumed he wasn't really acting, he was just playing himself.
I think psychologically, when you're trying to portray a character or trying to act something out, it's got to be something that's close to you. Otherwise, you're not going to really be able to play it good. And I think that may be why he was so good at that role.
He wasn't Bishop. Pac was a smart, intellectual, revolutionary kind of cat.
And the real Tupac Shakur was actually trained at the Baltimore School for the Arts, where his best friend was Jada Pinkett, now Jada Pinkett Smith, a star in her own right. She knew Tupac the actor could play more than just crazy street hustlers, and she gave him a chance to show his real range.
I was just like, Pac, you gotta come on a different world, man. I said, I want you to come on and play this cat from Baltimore. He was like, for sure. Play! He played my ex-boyfriend, Piccolo, from Baltimore.
Piccolo.
L to the J. What's happening, baby?
When they wanted to write that role, I was like, this is how it should flow. You know, and it just fit right into the dynamics of our relationship, and it was nothing foreign to either one of us. He was great. I mean, because he was just so authentic and just so real. And like I said, it was just so raw.
Tupac continued to surprise people with a tender performance in the 1993 John Singleton movie Poetic Justice, in which he starred opposite Janet Jackson. Could this be the same man who'd been so scary bad as Bishop in Juice?
Keisha here.
How's my grandbaby doing?
Bad as ever.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to stay with us for good.
From Juice to Poetic Justice, both of those were Tupac a little bit. You know, they were both certain sides to him. A person just isn't one thing.
As strong as he wasn't afraid to show how vulnerable he was. It was a strength in his vulnerability, and not everybody can do that.
You definitely have to have range. You know, through his music, everybody's seen that he could always make a hard song and then make a compassionate song, so it's only right for him to do that acting.
Once he'd established his range as an actor, Tupac returned to playing tough street guys in movies like Bullet, Gridlocked, and Gang Related, and he won the respect of his fellow actors.
Roll style!
I'd worked with him with Brother Rem, and he was there, man. It was like watching any great, watching Pacino, watching Denzel, watching Tom Hanks. Pac was the same way. You're in a scene, they're in their zone, and you're just really committed. And Pac was committed. Like, when he kicked me on the floor, he really kicked me on the floor.
Get the f*** out! You don't hear me? Am I stuttering? Get the f*** out, man! Get out!
I didn't really appreciate that too much, but I stayed in character.
Tupac the actor became a new kind of star for a new generation of movie-going youth, and his screen career also encouraged future rap stars to try their hand at acting.
That just made everyone that ever wanted to even think about acting, you know, pursue acting.
Just me watching him and, you know, being a fan, definitely, I, you know, got some tips from him. That did let me know that it could be done. I'm figuring that out now as I get more opportunity to do movies and TV.
This is the show we call Doggy Fizzle.
He definitely showed us there's no real limit. I mean, in the 40s and 50s, a lot of actors and actresses would sing and do variety shows and do movies, have albums, and would just be multi-talented. And it's just been a long time since we had that, and he really lived that up while he was here.
He's a brain actor, and I think had he still been around, it was just a matter of time before he won his Academy.
Looking back now at his brief, tragically abbreviated life, it's clear that the most complex role Tupac ever played was that of himself.
You kind of watched every single step that he made. Every time he did something, he kind of lived a movie, you know? It's like you'd almost wake up every day like, all right, what is Pac going to do today?
Tupac himself talks about all the things he did and all the thoughts and feelings he had in the gripping new movie Tupac Resurrection, arriving in theaters on November 14th.
I love women. I'm not gonna lie. I love women with a passion. I do. I feel like sometimes now I just be wanting to call Prince and just be like, can we hang? Because I love women like he loves women.
Tupac Shakur, the subject of the new documentary Tupac Resurrection, due out November 14th, was a great rapper and a gifted actor, but he was also a tireless opponent of the racial oppression he saw throughout his life and the poverty that fed into it. Tupac knew about growing up poor firsthand.
When I met Pac, he owned two pairs of pants and a sweater. When in his house, he had a mattress on the floor with no sheets. When I say poor, I mean poor. He had nothing.
Listening to him made you see that there's another side, and reality ain't always the, you know, glamorous side of it.
Everybody isn't brought up in those environments, so they're not as conscious. Like, they don't feel as strongly about things as he felt.
Lord knows I tried, been a witness to homicides and drive-bys taking lives, little kids die.
He just took on the world, and I think people connected to that passion. They connected to that heart, to that soul.
Tupac's mother, Afeni Shakur, was a leader in the Black Panther movement in the 1970s, and it was she who fundamentally molded his political consciousness.
I was taught about the movement of Martin Luther King. Pac came in the picture and he schooled me on Malcolm X, the Black Panther Party, and so on and so on and so on. He was the president of the Junior Black Panther Party, and it was something that he lived.
Anybody who didn't listen to Pac and just shrugged off what he was saying was missing something that they could have took with for the rest of their life.
How you gonna be a man and we start?
Go ahead.
You know? And you can walk by five different houses, ain't a man in either one of them motherfuckers. How we gonna be a man?
I think Pac represented, you know, the struggle of a lot of young people in America, particularly young Black folks in America.
Pac was definitely an activist. He puts the information in the music.
I hear Brenda's got a baby, but Brenda's barely got a brain. A damn shame, the girl can hardly spell her name. That's not our problem, that's up to Brenda's family. Well, let me show you how it affects our whole community.
There'll always be projects, there'll always be ghettos, there'll always be poverty. And hopefully maybe one day somebody will come along and change that. But until then, we always got his music to remind us of those issues.
Tupac stands out as a warrior. He was always fighting for a cause of freedom. You know, he was just always warring for us and making us understand that he was within the struggle with us.
Tired of being trapped in this vicious cycle. If one more cop harasses me, I just might go psycho.
He stood up against everybody. He stood up against the cops, the way society was, you know, the government, everything. Everything that was fucked up in the world, he would talk about it.
Tupac may have rapped about the everyday struggles faced by Black Americans, but his lyrical brilliance and his uncompromising honesty struck a chord with a large white audience as well.
I guess no matter what color you was or where you came from, you felt like you could relate to him. He made you feel like you knew him.
I think he reached a lot of white audiences because that passion is not black or white.
And he wasn't just a gangster rapper either. Tupac's encompassing sensibility gave expression to women's experiences too.
To all the ladies having babies on their own, I know it's kind of rough and you're feeling all alone. Daddy's long gone and he left you by your lonesome. Thanks alone for my kids, even if nobody else wants them.
He dealt with the truth and he touched on women having babies too young.
I know you're fed up, ladies, but keep your head up.
Yeah, Keep Your Head Up is a really powerful song. No matter what you're going through, keep your head up.
Tupac Shakur died 7 years ago, but his voice remains, and it still speaks to a new generation.
Man, you could probably start courses off of Tupac in colleges somewhere. You could have a whole Tupacology. Brand new science you create over Tupac.
In fact, classes focused on Tupac's work are now being taught at Harvard and the University of California at Berkeley.
I really like this video because it really presents Tupac in a way that a lot of you have never imagined him or thought he would be like.
Tupac's legacy will also live on at the Tupac Amaru Shakur Center for the Arts, which will be built in Atlanta and will expose kids to the arts and encourage individual self-expression.
That means more sometimes than trying to reach a million people, because it's too hard to get your attention across to a million people. If you get to those four or five, it might be a leader in that four or five that can have that voice.
In Tupac Resurrection, Shakur inspires others to rebel against oppression.
I'm doing it for the kid that really lives a thug life and feels like it's hopeless.
Throughout the film, he also expresses a complex understanding of his own life.
There are things that people need to know about him, and they need to have a real serious 360-degree understanding of his perspective. I think there was only one size televised, him being cuffed up, him being shot. Tupac always saw a more vivid view. There's a lot of sides to him that I think the world should see.
His influence is so big that it's like everybody is taking something from his music.
I'm proud of his existence and I'm glad I knew him. He was one of the greatest characters ever, the God ever written.
That cat right there ain't gonna never be nothing like that again.
There is nobody, nobody like that man. I don't care how many records you sell. I don't care how popular you are. There is no comparison, none. And I don't know when there ever will be.
Check it, I grew up, screw up, got introduced to the game, got an ounce of chopping rocks overnight. The Biggie Smalls trying to turn into the Black Frank White. Even the cops tried to sue me, so what can I do but stay true? Sipping 22s and brewing, now the media is trying to test me. Got the press asking questions, trying to stress me. Misery is all I see, that's my mind state. My history with the police to shake the crime rate. My main man had two strikes slip, got arrested and flipped. He screamed thug life and emptied it. Got tired of running from the police.